Hi, everyone, and Happy New Year. Welcome to the Pacific Neuroscience Institute in Providence, Southern California Neuroscience Grand Rounds. We're so happy to welcome you here to the new year for what I anticipate will be a progression in terms of the amazing talks that we have available in the realm of neurosciences. Very excited about having my friend and new colleague, Dr. Michael Yong, join us today to speak with you. Dr. Michael Yong is board certified in otolaryngology, which is head and neck surgery, and fellowship trained specifically in neurorhinology with a focus on advanced sinus and skull-based surgery. He is one of our more recent and esteemed additions to the Pacific Neuroscience Institute, where he provides full service general otolaryngology care, specifically with extra focus and attention down here in the South Bay. He has an expertise in sinonasal and skull-based disorders and specializes in minimally invasive endoscopic techniques. I can tell you from a personal note, I've been incredibly pleased to have him spend more time with us down here at Little Company in Torrance, where he works with us to perform endoscopic endonasal surgeries that address both the benign and malignant skull-based disorders that we've talked about in previous discussions. Dr. Yong is a Canadian hailing from hometown of Winnipeg in Manitoba, where he completed his BS at Queen's University in Ontario before crossing over to the West Coast to do his residency during his medical school, in British Columbia in Vancouver. He stayed there to do his ENT residency, where he completed a two-year research fellowship focused on hearing loss research, where he traveled to Johns Hopkins to do that. At the same time, he also earned a dual master of public health and an MBA during his time, so incredibly busy. And following his residency, he completed a highly coveted endoscopic endonasal fellowship at Stanford University in sinus and skull-based surgery. In addition to his numerous clinical interests, he's got a passion for promoting equitable access to healthcare. And through his research, he combines his expertise of health economics and population health with clinical research to tackle these issues on a larger scale. And that was one of the big things that excited our leaders at the Pacific Neuroscience Institute of cajoling him to join our group to expand about some of the tremendous research, some of which he'll talk about today. So with that and without further ado, Dr. Yong, thank you for joining us, and the floor is yours.
Very much, Dr. Sivakumar. Thank you. Everyone can hear me. Can you guys hear me? Just want to double check. Okay, great. Thanks for the introduction. As Wally said, my name is Michael. I'm one of the staff rhinologists at PNI in Providence. And I work both at St. John's and at Little Company, and I'm trying to expand PNI's presence from the ENT perspective down in the So thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk on olfaction. I hope everyone can walk away from today with at least a few memorable points that might improve your ability to deliver care to these patients and maybe recognize this issue a little bit more than you might realize. So just a quick summary of what we'll cover today. First, we'll introduce why smell is important and what can happen when it's impaired. And then
Dr.
next,
Dr. Yong, I'm so sorry to interrupt. Yeah. Could you share your slides? I think when you got kicked out, it stopped the screen sharing.
Did it? I see. I got you. Hang on 1 second. Gotcha. Can you see that?
Yep. Looks
yeah.
good.
Okay. Great. Let me go through the objectives again. This presentation is scheduled to finish a little early so that everyone can have question time, stuff to related to the presentation and maybe not related to the presentation. If you have questions about that, you think I can answer. Quick summary. First, we'll introduce why smell is important and what can happen when it's impaired. And then we'll briefly cover some of the physiology behind our ability to smell, which in turn has ramifications on how we diagnose and treat these disorders. And then we'll cover a practical approach to diagnosing olfactory disorders and then finish off with some practical takeaways for initial management of olfactory dysfunction in general. Just quick disclosures, I am a consultant for these two companies, but neither engagements affect today's talk. So most of the time when we think of neuroscience, we think of our ability to see, to hear, to move our body. However, one of the most unappreciated senses is, of course, our ability to smell. So while you might not consciously think of or appreciate your continued ability to smell every day, it's something that is really noticeable if you happen to lose that sense. First of all, our sense of smell really helps us to avoid dangerous environmental hazards, such as if there was a fire burning inside a building, or if you were to encounter a skunk in the wild. And then more on the everyday side of things, our smell helps to guide our eating habits, enabling us to tell if food is rotting or if potential food items might not be safe due to their bitter or sour taste. And I say taste because about 80 to 90% of our ability to taste is actually linked to our ability to smell. And then lastly, our ability to smell also helps with interactions between other people. Although our sense of smell is not as keen as, say, dogs, we are still able to recognize scents from certain familiar people. And then in addition, smell can affect our perception of meeting new people. And that makes sense when you think about how the current worldwide market size of perfume is about $62 billion. And really, additionally, our ability to smell is closely linked to the emotions that we feel and our ability to form strong memories that are linked to emotions. When we look at a picture of a flower, are we immediately a little happier because of the color and the shape of the flower? Or is it because we remember that in real life, we would all go up to a flower and smell fragrance? Our ability to remember what the sunflower smells like and vice versa, being able to smell a sunflower and be reminded of running through maybe a flower field, is something that's intrinsic to our memory formation and recall. And then similarly at home, our ability to smell is crucial for us to be able to cook or enjoy a meal properly. And then as many of you coffee drinkers may be able to attest to, I'm not one of them, unfortunately, this picture would not evoke nearly the same emotions if you could imagine not being able to smell your morning coffee at all. And for some people, they might even say that the inability to smell would defeat the entire purpose of drinking coffee. Considering these examples, you know, previous research has shown that when we lose our sense of smell, this loss can lead to a general loss of pleasure and depression. From functional imaging and anatomical studies, we know that there are shared neural pathways between the areas in the brain responsible for emotion. A possible mechanism for the linkage between smell dysfunction and worsened emotional state includes decreased or altered neural signaling from the olfactory bulbs, the associated cortices. Likewise, when you become depressed or anxious, general withdrawal and decreased olfactory input might further cause these pathways to degenerate. There's also a wealth of research demonstrating that our ability to smell enables us to form odor-evoked memories and can help induce positive physiologic and emotional responses. Olfactory dysfunction is relatively prevalent, especially as we look at aging. About 40% of adults over the age of 65 have some degree of olfactory dysfunction, either mild, ranging to severe. And with this risk, it increases as we age. Men also seem to have a higher prevalence of general objective olfactory dysfunction. But interestingly, women are more subjectively affected by their olfactory dysfunction. And some researchers have postulated that this might be due to the greater social importance of olfaction in women than men. Looking at it from another angle, about one in every three patients that we see, general population-wise, present with some degree of smell loss, and will experience one or any of these associated symptoms on a regular basis: general loss of pleasure, sadness, fear, frustration. This can be especially difficult to manage considering that many of these patients are also elderly as well. Olfactory dysfunction has been linked to the 2014 smell test. And the results were surprising. It really showed that the risk of mortality was about 18% higher among those 65 and older per 1-point decrease in smell test on multivariate analysis. And this association was significant and remains so even after adjusting for depression and cognitive impairment. And I just want to remind everyone that this field of research in olfaction is relatively young. Prior to Buck and Axel's seminal paper on characterizing odorant receptors and the organization of the olfactory epithelium, olfactory bulb, and olfactory cortex, which won them the Nobel Prize in 1991, there were only really about 5,000 publications related to olfaction. Fast forward to the year 2020, and there were over 2,000 publications in that year alone. So it's really a field that has been undergoing exponential growth. Now, to briefly review the physiology of olfaction, we'll start at the region in the nasal cavity, which is really my my area of expertise, where the olfactory receptors live and extend their receptors into that ethmoid skull base of the cribriform plate. It's here that thousands of distinct odor molecules that we breathe in every second interact with their appropriate receptors, sending neural signals to the collection of synapses between the olfactory receptor neurons and the downstream neurons at the glomerulus. And then after these signals are grouped together, they are sent to the cortex through the olfactory nerve. And what's also important to note is that it's not just the olfactory receptor neurons that play an important role in the olfactory epithelium. The functioning of the cilia within the epithelium, the functioning of the supporting cells within the epithelium, and the integrity of the neural connections all play a role. Information from the olfactory neuron is then transmitted to many different locations collectively categorized as the primary olfactory cortex, which really encompasses areas like the anterior olfactory nucleus, the olfactory tubercle, the piriform cortex, the amygdala, and the lateral entorhinal area. These are connected ipsilaterally and contralaterally, and these areas also connect to the hippocampus and the lateral hypothalamus. So it's important to note that as well, that information is relayed in a receptotopic organization, meaning that different areas of the cortex are relaying different specific information corresponding to the nature of the smell stimulus. Because we talk about the causes of olfactory disorders, I'd like to quickly run through some definitions first after we finish up this physiology talk, which might be confusing, but we use clinically to describe how people's smell is affected adversely. Anosmia is the complete loss of smell. There can be some trace objective smell function, but not enough to make a meaningful difference in everyday function. When we say hyposmia, that's the partial loss of smell. Parosmia is a distortion of smell in the presence of a smell stimulus. And often this distortion is unpleasant, such as interpreting a normal smell like a rose or food as smelling something like smoke or garbage or even feces. Phantosmia is the sensation of smelling something when nothing is there. Likewise, this also often refers to an unpleasant smell. These four definitions are really the main ones that we use to talk about disorders of smell, although there may be some classifications of some of these definitions that may be a little bit more nuanced, but these are the general ones that we use. And because there are so many causes of olfactory loss, I like to think about the causes in a sort of anatomically grouped manner. So there are those disorders that result in more of a conductive loss, inflammatory disorders being the big one, like chronic rhinosinusitis. Other things like intense allergic inflammation and sinonasal tumors could also contribute to this. Then we talk about those disorders affecting the epithelium directly, which can be inflammatory in nature as well, due to the dysfunction of the respiratory lining function, but also include big categories like post-viral loss, which includes COVID-19. These infectious causes generally affect the olfactory receptor neurons or the associated supporting cells. And then traumatic causes can result in shearing of the axonal projections, which can result in permanent loss that's pretty difficult to recover from. And then higher up, tumors or dysfunction of the olfactory bulbs themselves can result in smell loss. And these often can include things like esthesioneuroblastomas or meningiomas of the skull base most commonly. And then finally, other intracranial pathology, neoplastic or not, can also cause issues as well. So what's the total list of things that can cause olfactory dysfunction? We'll run through this really quickly because it's actually a long list, but it's helpful to think of the etiology of smell dysfunction that has a reflection directly on how we diagnose and how we might have an approach to treatment of these. So as I talked before, sinonasal inflammatory disease can result in both a conductive loss of smell, but also affecting some of the respiratory lining, which is really integral to being able to first detect smell inside the nose. Head trauma can again result in hyposmia from direct shearing of those olfactory fibers and axonal projections, which can be actually very difficult, if not impossible, to recover from. Post-viral causes, namely COVID-19, which is at the top of our mind lately in the past few years, can directly cause smell loss from either attacking the receptors, the olfactory receptor neurons, in the case of non-COVID-19 viral infections, or in the case of COVID-19, affecting the sustentacular cells or supporting cells that can really have an effect on a dysfunction of the receptors themselves. A number of different medications can also cause differences in the ability to detect smells correctly or be able to detect smells at the regular threshold that you are supposed to. Radiation can definitely affect the area because of direct radiation-induced damage to the olfactory cleft and to the olfactory neurons and the associated downstream structures. Systemic diseases, such as autoimmune diseases, even vitamin and mineral deficiency disorders, endocrine disorders like diabetes, and renal failure can also affect the ability to smell properly. Sinonasal or intracranial tumors can obviously cause both a conductive loss, but also a direct loss in terms of affecting the olfactory epithelium at the olfactory cleft, or even affecting the olfactory bulb in the case of ischios or meningiomas. Increasing age can also affect the ability to interpret smells correctly, but also the health directly of the olfactory neurons and direct supporting cells. Neurodegenerative diseases, such as Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease, can also affect our ability to smell. Neurotransmitter diseases, such as autism, schizophrenia, depression, and OCD, can also affect our ability to smell, but might be something that we don't typically think of, but maybe something that, you know, us as a neuroscience group regularly interacts with. Other causes such as seizures, migraines can also indirectly affect our ability to smell. Congenital causes can also affect our ability to smell if there is agenesis or malformation of the olfactory bulbs and also malformation of the olfactory clefts and associated structures in that region. And then extremely high or low BMI can also affect our ability to smell. And then, of course, all those, and then, of course, smoking can also affect it, both from a conductive standpoint and also from injury to the respiratory epithelium. And then all those causes which don't fall into any of these categories, idiopathic, can also lead to smell loss. And then one larger one that is more often what I see in postoperative patients who've had sinonasal or endonasal skull-based surgery is resection of the area in the olfactory cleft, or resection of the superior turbinates, or those areas where smell fibers live inside the nose. And that's more of an iatrogenic cause of smell loss. So important points to note on history and physical really is reflective of the causes that we just went through that can contribute to olfactory dysfunction. So really quantifying and qualitatively assessing the actual smell dysfunction, whether it's hyposmia, whether it's anosmia, or whether it's a type of parosmia or phantosmia, is important. And then evaluating, you know, patients for a bunch of other symptoms, like whether they have any sinonasal symptoms, whether they have associated neurologic symptoms, their history of head trauma, and history of any other of these causative factors like infection, radiation, headaches, family history, that sort of thing. And then, of course, going through a general health screening for comorbidities. And then specifically on physical examination, I do like to do a quick screening neurologic examination on these patients, and then a head and neck exam and an ear exam, because aberrations in the head and neck region as well as the ear region can affect the neurologic structures that are associated with smell and taste. And then, of course, I always do a nasal endoscopy on these patients, which you might not be able to do if you don't have the equipment to do a flexible or a rigid nasal endoscopy, but it would be good to send to someone like myself or an ENT that can evaluate the sinonasal region to evaluate for any conductive losses of smell or inflammatory causes as well. And then the big question that a lot of people always ask me is imaging helpful for hyposmia, and when could it be helpful? So I'm going to provide you a really high level practical approach to thinking about this. So CT I generally use for, and it's generally recommended for any patients where we want to rule out sinonasal inflammatory disease or sinonasal tumor or something conductive in nature. if someone has had previous sinonasal surgery or endonasal skull-based surgery, it's really important to get a CT if it's been a while since that's happened to characterize exactly what the extent of ongoing disease is or what the nature of the previous surgery was. You know, if there was a significant resection of those important areas where the smell fibers live inside the nose. And then, of course, if there's a suspicion for a neoplasm. An MRI can also be helpful for neoplastic causes, especially intracranial tumors, because it does give a little bit better definition in the intracranial cavity than a CT may, and then other various intracranial causes, but also can be helpful for prognosis. If someone has had smell loss for quite some time, if you want to evaluate what the caliber of the olfactory bulbs are, and then much less often, but sometimes used for more research purposes, are things like functional MRI, which can quantify, you know, someone's smell loss in terms of not just the structural definition and robustness of the olfactory bulbs, but also the functioning of those associated cortical areas. And then more so for research, nuclear medical examination can be helpful for post-traumatic causes of hyposmia and also for prognosis similar to MRI. But really we focus on CT and MRI as the imaging modalities of choice for an initial evaluation of smell loss. Now, moving on to quantitative tests that evaluate for hyposmia, there are a bunch of different tests that exist, but I generally classify them into very brief, moderately brief, and longer quantitative smell tests. Now, in the very brief category, we talk about, you know, tests that take less than 5 minutes to do and are pretty quick screening tests just to quantify whether someone does actually have objective hyposmia or not. And again, these are generally used for screening and should be followed up by some sort of definitive testing. Some of you may be familiar with some of these. There's the quick smell test, these sticks that you can use to put on parchment paper and ask people to smell them, and then six item pocket smell tests, and then four odor pocket smell tests, which are also quick things. Some of these tests involve scratch and sniff. Some of them, like the sticks test here, involve putting a little bit of material on a parchment paper and then smelling it afterwards. These are generally the quickest ways to evaluate smell. The moderately brief smell tests are more of a clinical definitive test that we use in the clinic, ranging anywhere from 5 to 20 minutes, and generally test both identification of smells and discrimination between different smells. And so this can be a little bit more helpful than just the fast screening test and might be able to help quantify exactly, you know, if someone falls in the mild to moderate to severe amount of hyposmia. And this involves tests like the popular University of Pennsylvania smell test, often used in a lot of research studies to compare amounts of smell lost, the brief smell identification test, and the eight odor pocket smell test, which is the one that the NHANES study on the mortality used. And then longer tests that are usually used for more research purposes, ranging in the time period of over 20 minutes to do. But these can test also threshold testing in addition to discrimination and identification. And they're the most definitive type of test. And they involve things like the sniff and sticks, which is the most popular one, as well as other various research tests. And it's important to note that these tests are generally forced choice tests, which make them easier to administer and more reliable and correlate better with each other when we're comparing smell tests to each other. And then lastly, quality of life testing can be useful as well. And I find that it is more useful in patients with concurrent inflammatory disease. There are validated olfactory quality of life instruments that are actually best used to evaluate people with olfactory dysfunction. One of the popular ones is called the Questionnaire of Olfactory Disorders, specifically to test people with smell loss. But more often in clinic, with people coming in with initial, you know, questions of whether they have an inflammatory disease and it may or may not be related to smell disorders, which is most commonly what I see, the most common quality of life test that I administer patients in clinic is called the SNOT 22 test, the sinonasal outcome test, which evaluates for many different symptoms that are related to sinonasal inflammatory disease, one of which is smell. But generally speaking, it's quite limited in terms of its ability to evaluate specific smell complaints. And it's generally recommended that a more validated olfactory focused quality of life instrument is used if we're going to be evaluating for smell loss in particular. But really, in general settings, like I said, the olfactory quality of life survey isn't used super often. Just because, you know, when I'm seeing patients, especially for smell loss, it's also to evaluate whether they have any associated inflammatory disease and to sort out a number of other different issues. Other objective testing is situationally useful, and it's generally not used in clinic just because it's a little bit cumbersome to do so, as you can see in this picture. The electroolfactogram is something that is used more in research, but it's actually more of a gold standard objective testing to be able to test whether someone can or can't smell certain things. It uses the summated potentials of those olfactory receptor neurons in response to certain olfactory stimuli, and it measures those responses. And research in this area, like I said before, suggests that there are certain areas of the olfactory epithelium that are specific to certain odor types. And then, of course, corresponds to those certain parts of the olfactory cortex that also map to those certain regions which correspond to the olfactory stimulants that we're noticing in our nose, either pleasant, noxious, or otherwise. But again, it's not currently used in a lot of clinical practice, but it is an active area of research to try to translate what we can do in the laboratory to more of a clinical setting. And it may be something that is going to be on the horizon, you know, in the next decade or two. Other testing that's situational and of limited utility as well is blood work or lab work. You know, this is really should be really targeted to things, to situations where we think that there's a high suspicion that something else in terms of their general health or comorbidities may be contributing to their smell dysfunction. There's some evidence that micronutrient abnormalities may play a role. So checking for B12 has been postulated by some people, but is of limited use, you know, practically speaking in the clinic. A number of other micronutrients have been questioned as to what their role in hyposmia might be, but there's little data to support supplementation of these, and also limited data to support checking for these on a routine basis. There can be some risk associated with supplementation, especially with things like zinc, because there is a narrow spectrum of therapeutic window is narrow and can result in toxicity. Other things like hypogonadism and laboratory tests for Parkinson's and Alzheimer's can be situationally helpful. But again, I don't routinely test for these things when I do see people with hyposmia come into the office. It's again, really situational. And then now looking at a really practical diagnostic approach, like we talked before about imaging, what I usually use CT for is inflammatory disease or a suspicion for neoplastic causes. And then MRI, I usually use for neoplastic causes, or if the patients have long-term loss that I'm trying to prognosticate, or if they don't have any other etiology identified, meaning like if there's no clear history of like an infection that can result in a post-viral loss, or if there's no history of COVID infection, if there's no trauma, if there's no history of inflammatory disease, if there's nothing that fits within to those categories, an MRI may be helpful just to rule out an intracranial cause or a neoplastic cause of their smell loss. And then importantly, I don't do imaging on the other side of the coin if there is an identifiable cause that's non-inflammatory, which means that it's not chronic rhinosinusitis and it's non-neoplastic in origin, meaning it's not from a tumor. Meaning that if there is something that we can say, such as, you know, they had a trauma event which led to their hyposmia, or they had an infection or COVID-19 infection that led to a hyposmia afterwards, that would fall into the category of an identifiable non-inflammatory, non-neoplastic cause that wouldn't necessarily need routine imaging. And then this is just in case you want to take a screenshot or a picture of, you know, the diagnostic approach that we generally use. This is taken directly from the international consensus statement published by the American group of rhinologists. We start by, you know, evaluating what their subjective complaint is. Is it hyposmia? Is it anosmia? Is it type of parosmia or phantosmia? We take a detailed history to really give us a clue as to any suggestive causes of their smell loss. We almost always perform some sort of validated or quantifiable smell test, either a brief screening test or some sort of clinical test ranging in that moderately brief test, 5 to 20 minutes or so. And then, of course, we do a thorough head and neck examination, including ear examination, a neurologic screening examination, and importantly, a nasal endoscopy. And then we decide if imaging is necessary. Again, see either CT or MRI based on what we think is the cause of their smell loss. And again, if there is an identifiable non-neoplastic, non-inflammatory cause, we generally don't pursue imaging. And then more of the treatment side of things, which I will talk about in just the next few slides, is really tailored towards that, that etiology of what we think is contributing to their hyposmia. Just a quick thing on the natural history of olfactory dysfunction. Rates of spontaneous recovery are not really well understood. And it also is a reflection of what we think is causing that hyposmia. You know, head trauma, like we talked about, that can result in those shearing of axonal projections of the olfactory receptor neurons is pretty difficult to recover from. It generally is regarded as a little bit worse prognosis for recovery than things like post-viral causes. But as you can see, this range of recovery is pretty wide, and there aren't really any good studies that show definitively, you know, what that rate of recovery is, because it can happen over a period of time. You know, from what we know physiologically about olfactory neuron regrowth, and olfactory neuron regrowth does happen because there are stem cells that live within that region that can regenerate function in that region. It generally does take about 30 days for an olfactory neuron to regrow, and about 60 to 90 days in total after an injury for a population to regrow of those olfactory neurons back to a quote unquote healthy state at a minimum. And then 90 days to about a year to typically recover olfactory dysfunction. So just because those olfactory neurons recover and regrow doesn't mean that they are functioning normally. And that actually has a ramification on people who have hyposmia, but also things like parosmia and phantosmia, because we generally think of parosmias and phantosmias as a dysfunction of the smell fibers, either because they're damaged or aren't quite functioning properly, or there are a reduced amount of olfactory receptor neurons that are functioning that may play a role in being able to smell only certain types of smells. And you can imagine how you know, things that we smell every day have many different elements of smell to them. You know, coffee might be bitter, but might be sweet as well, and might be aromatic. And if we're not detecting some of those elements of smell, that can cause us to interpret smells in a different way. And then going back to that timeline, you know, 3 years, after 3 years, you know, that chance for recovery of smell, if someone hasn't had a recovery of smell after the initial injury, does become quite minimal. But there are case reports of smell recovery happening up to 9 years after initial incident. So you can see here how that range of smell recovery is quite large. And so right now, we just don't have a really good estimate of how long smell recovery can take and if it is going to recover as well. And like I said, parosmia and phantosmia, because these are intricately linked to smell dysfunction in terms of a hyposmia or an anosmia, and even if olfactory function does recover from regrowth of those neurons or fibers, it can be a lasting issue, because if there are a decreased number of receptors that are now functioning, or there are aberrant connections that are formed because of that recovery, that can result in a distortion of smell. So really, like I said, treatment should be etiology specific, and it really is a reflection of all these different causes of smell loss that can be contributing. But really, you know, those top ones that I listed here, the inflammatory disease, head trauma, post-viral causes, those are generally the most frequent ones that we encounter in practice. And I'll give you sort of my practical takeaway for things that I often use to treat smell loss in patients that I see. So topical steroid irrigations, usually in the form of a nasal saline rinse impregnated with a steroid, and budesonide is usually the one that I use, can be helpful, surprisingly, unsurprisingly, for sinonasal inflammatory disease, but surprisingly also for non-sinonasal causes. And there's a good amount of evidence, of course, to show that intranasal steroid sprays and rinses can have a beneficial effect in the context of inflammatory sinonasal disease. But it's important to note that this can take quite some time to take effect. So I generally tell people that you have to use a constant intranasal steroid for up to 3 months for it to take full effect. But interestingly as well, even in patients who don't have significant sinonasal inflammatory disorders, such as when we look inside the nose by endoscopy or by CT scan characterizing that amount of inflammation inside the sinonasal cavities, there is research to show that a clinically significant improvement is appreciated by these patients who are empirically put on a nasal steroid irrigation when they have hyposmia. And there's a number of different explanations for this, but there may be some degree of non-inflammatory related dysfunction that's going on inside that olfactory cleft that responds favorably to an intranasal steroid. And the dosage that I usually use is budesonide 0.5 milligram per 2 mL, dumped directly into this to the saline rinse bottle. That's usually about 240 cc's. And you rinse half the bottle on one side of the nose, half the bottle on the other side of the nose. And you do this twice per day. And I tell them to continue it for at least 3 months. And if it's having a beneficial effect, I do encourage them to continue using those nasal steroid irrigations, because we have a good amount of research to show that, you know, even at twice per day irrigations at this dosage, there's very little, if any, systemic absorption. And there are really is a minority of patients who have any side effects, such as suppression of their AHPA. The other thing that can be helpful, more so in the endonasal skull-based population who experience hyposmia after this, but there is some research to investigate whether this might have a beneficial effect in other populations, is omega-3 supplementation. Again, it's pretty low risk, but beneficial in certain populations, such as this endonasal skull-based surgery population that has had endonasal skull-based surgeries, such as those that, you know, I and Dr. Sivakumar perform for cellar or paracellar based pathology or masses. And like I said, it is currently being investigated as a treatment for other causes, such as post-viral or post-COVID-19 smell loss. But just an important thing to note is that it should be considered to be avoided in people with bleeding disorders or who are concurrently using blood thinners, because it can lead to some thinning of the blood. The most common one that I recommend is the Nature Made brand, 1,000 milligrams twice a day for, again, 3 months or over. And I do recommend the Nature Made one because there's been a number of studies that have been done showing that, you know, the supplement market isn't very well regulated, and Nature Made tends to be the brand that actually has a higher concentration of the actual omega-3 acid inside. And then quick side note is that, you know, either fish oil or non-fish oil omega-3 supplementation is completely fine. It doesn't have to be the fish oil one in case people are allergic to fish. And then lastly, the common one that I recommend for people is olfactory training. It is low risk, but it does require long-term patient commitment. There's a good amount of evidence to show that olfactory training does lead to a significant recovery of smell loss in these patients, especially for post-infectious smell loss patients. You know, over and above that, there is some evidence to show that it's beneficial outside this population too, for a wide range of olfactory dysfunction causes. And the theory is that, you know, olfaction, like we talked about in this presentation, is not just related to the olfactory receptor neurons and the functionality of the epithelium inside the sinonasal cavity. It really is dependent on those supporting cells, on the olfactory bulb connections to the olfactory neurons, and the associated connections to that those cortical areas that are important for smell, but also emotion and memory forming. And so there is a thought that, you know, rehabilitation for those areas and stimulating that neuroplasticity to reform those connections in a beneficial way can be helpful for patients. So classic olfactory training is really predicated upon this theory that there are four essential smells that really help us to recover our smell, or that our general smell is based on. And these include a floral smell, a fruity smell, a resinous one, and aromatic. So generally speaking, these correlate to rose, lemon, eucalyptus, and clove. And there are a lot of different olfactory training kits that are available even online. I generally actually refer people to, you know, Amazon or their favorite online store to look for a general four odor smell kit, which comes with these exact smells. And I encourage them to continue it for 6 months or longer, because this is generally the timeline that's been looked at to see whether they will have some recovery of their function due to that changing neuroplasticity that they have. And the way you use it is you have to use it twice per day, and you smell, you take each one of those smells, and you have to do it for each nostril. And they start out by smelling close to their nose by inhaling deeply. And then eventually, as time goes by, we'll tell them to hold the odor successively further and further away from their nose to be able to stimulate their olfactory system with a lower threshold stimulus. But olfactory training is often is something that I very often recommend for patients, especially those who have had shorter to medium term smell loss. It can be a little bit difficult for people who've had really long term smell loss because of that theory that that neuroplasticity isn't as good in those patients. So just a general treatment approach, you know, baseline, I almost always recommend some sort of nasal steroid irrigation, omega-3 supplementation unless it's contraindicated, and olfactory training. And this I usually generally recommend that people continue for at least 3 to 6 months to see if there's any benefit. And then situational are, you know, especially if someone has inflammatory sinonasal disease and concurrent hyposmia, endoscopic sinonasal surgery could be helpful for them. Consideration of a biologic medication, and this is more on the sinonasal inflammatory side of things, could be helpful. Something like dupilumab, mepolizumab, or omalizumab for those people who have very intense sinonasal inflammatory disease. And then any management of their comorbidities, like we talked about, all of those other systemic conditions, medication-related stuff, management of their headaches or other neurologic conditions. And then there's a consideration of novel treatments for hyposmia that's currently going on. One of the novel treatments that I'll touch on just briefly today is platelet-rich plasma, which has drawn a lot of media attention for not just hyposmia, but for a number of other general conditions, such as arthritis and other systemic conditions. But platelet-rich plasma has been explored now in an initial randomized control trial that was just published actually last year by the Stanford group by injection of platelet-rich plasma. So platelet-rich plasma is this material that we use to, we do a blood draw from patients, we spin it down to isolate that that plasma component of the patient's own serum, and then we concentrate that serum with the platelets and inject it back into a specific region. And in this case, we inject it back into the olfactory cleft. And that recent RCT in 2023 evaluated 35 patients, of which 26 completed the trial, and it showed that injection three times separated by 2 weeks intervals in between each of those injections actually resulted in a quite a significant recovery of smell. So a 57, just over half of those people reported smell recovery versus those that didn't get the PRP injection, you know, about 8% of those, that placebo group enjoyed some sort of improvement in their olfaction. So there was a pretty significant difference at a 3 month time point. And the odds ratio was about 12 and a half. So this is an area of continued research to see whether, you know, novel treatments like PRP could be helpful for a number of different conditions. This specific trial was for COVID-19 induced smell loss, but could be helpful for other causes of smell loss as well. With that, I know I didn't cover everything in the topic of smell loss and hyposmia, but hopefully I touched on a number of practical things that you might be able to take away. I do operate at three different locations, one in the Brentwood area, one in Santa Monica, and of course in the South Bay region. My email is here, and I will just text out in the chat my personal number so that if any of you have any patients or any questions even about smell loss or about sinonasal things or things that you might think I can provide some beneficial information on, please feel free to either email me or contact me through text or call me about anything that you might be wondering about, or especially patients that you might want me to see. With that, you know, I'll take any questions that any of you might have, both on the presentation, but also on related things that I didn't cover in the presentation that you might think I can answer.
Michael, that was fantastic. Thank you very much. You took on a Herculean task of covering a major, major nerve in about 40 minutes. So I commend you on that. And it's actually very exciting that there is a lot of work still to do with what's considered basically the most ancient and ancient of our cranial nerves. So it's very exciting with the whole process. A few questions from the audience here. Dr. Yazdi is asking, do you recommend Singulair for chronic sinus inflammatory disorders?
Good question. So I don't routinely prescribe the Singulair. I will usually leave it to a pulmonologist who's working with me, just because people with severe chronic sinonasal inflammatory disorders usually have some sort of concurrent asthma or some sort of concurrent pulmonary disease, of which I just feel more confident if a pulmonologist, a dedicated one, is managing that side of things. So for that reason, I usually don't prescribe Singulair. I find Singulair is more helpful in the case where people do have concurrent lower respiratory tract inflammation as well. And we know that because of this unified airway hypothesis, that a lot of people with very severe upper or lower respiratory tract inflammatory disorders will have concurrent disease in the other corresponding region. So short answer is I don't routinely use singulair, but it can be helpful. I think, in my personal opinion, for people who have concurrent disorder of both, but I usually don't use it in people with isolated chronic sinus disease.
Let me see here. There's some questions from the chat as well. Dr. Minosa asks, the budesonide nasal rinses, is it available at compounding pharmacists? The Rhinocort brand is usually not covered by health plans.
Yeah, I usually use a non-compounded version of the budesonide. The budesonide that I use, the 0.5 milligrams per 2 mL, actually does come in the respules that people will use for inhalant, but I dump them directly into the sinus rinse bottle, which is typically what a lot of sinonasal surgeons will do. It can be compounded at a compounding pharmacy. The one that we usually use up here in Santa Monica is the Santa Monica Compounding Pharmacy. And the advantage of that is the budesonide can be combined with other medications like topical antibiotics, which could be helpful in select circumstances. I have had issues with coverage sometimes, mostly for Medicare patients with budesonide. I still don't have a really great approach for doing this, but I do sometimes tell them that it can be the situation where it's not covered, where they have to pay out of pocket for it. I do tell them that, I usually put them on a trial period of like, let's try this for about 1 to 3 months to see if it might be helpful, just so that they don't, go walk out of the appointment thinking that they have to use this forever and have to pay like a lot of money for it. But usually speaking, patients shouldn't have to pay more than like $60 to $80 a month for twice per day budesonide rinses. If they're paying more for that, then they should be either sent to a compounding pharmacy or find another route so that they aren't paying as much money for it.
Gotcha. Dr. Mohammadi asks, does the loss of smell due to COVID recover in time, or is it more frequently permanent?
So, good question. I don't think we have really great data on this. Like I said before, that range in prognosis for smell recovery is super wide, right? The literature quotes like anywhere between 0 and 77% for post-infectious causes. I would say that COVID-19 probably is a little bit worse prognosis than a typical post-infectious cause, just because there's something about the COVID-19 virus that, smell loss has been forefront in our minds of, because so many people are experiencing it. Not everyone does, but a lot of people do. And it operates in a little bit of a different mechanism because it attacks those supporting cells instead of the receptor neurons themselves. And that may have a ramification on the ability of those receptor neurons, once they are damaged through an indirect pathway from the supporting cells, they might have a lower propensity or ability to recover or regrow in a fashion that connects those connections from the receptor neurons to the olfactory bulb properly in a way that brings them back to baseline. And that's why we see actually with a number of these patients don't just have hyposmia, they come in with some type of parosmia as well. And that has been a difficult thing even for the rhinologists to really get a grasp on. But again, there is a lot of research going into characterizing what relation parosmia has with hyposmia and what effect novel treatments like PRP injections may be able to have on those people even with parosmias.
Is there more of an indication for even super early smell retraining therapy for that, or it's really you just get them when you see them?
Yeah, so I usually put it up to the patient, just because olfactory training is a little bit of a commitment for patients. Mm-hmm. I say, if they come in like a week after their smell loss, I'll talk to them about the number of different things that we generally use for especially post-infectious hyposmia. But I'll say, you can give it another couple of weeks, you can give it a month to see if things are going to start improving. And I usually give people options. If it continues to improve, budesonide rinse and omega-3 are usually what I have them do. But if they either hit a plateau or they're not having any benefit on those other things, then I do talk to them about the olfactory training and encourage them to start it earlier rather than later. But I make sure that they know that it's something they have to continue and use regularly every day for like a period of like 3 to 6 months, because it's important to continue that and not have them like use it, you know, once or twice a week and then go off for a couple of weeks and then go back on it.
It's true.
Yeah.
Dr. Briganthi asks, we will have the slides later that Dr. Yong has graciously agreed to share. So thank you for that.
Yeah, of course.
With cosmetic rhinoplasty, is there any kind of noted smell deficit?
So, you know, so technically speaking, there shouldn't be, but there is always, I always tell people with nasal surgery, not so much external nasal surgery, but more endonasal, but I could see that there is some effect, you know, from an external approach, you can sort of result in some shock to the epithelium, the sinonasal epithelium, of which the olfactory epithelium is a part of. So I always tell them, especially for endonasal surgeries, but I may counsel them for external nasal surgeries, but I don't really do them anymore. That there is some shock that results to the olfactory epithelium. And even if we don't do anything to disrupt the olfactory epithelium in the olfactory cleft or in the superior turbinates or even in the middle turbinates, which have a little bit of smell fibers in them, and the nasal septum as well, there is a chance that they will have some hyposmia, which will take some time to recover. Just because for some reason, when we operate or manipulate inside the nose, it sometimes does cause a shock to those fibers that take them some time to recover. Usually, almost always, they recovers back to baseline, but I do counsel them that there's always a chance that there might be a small subgroup of patients that have some lasting hyposmia afterwards, even if we don't physically resect those portions of the sinonasal cavity.
That probably is a good segue. Could you speak for a moment on our technique for endonasal surgeries with this specific point in mind?
Yeah, sure. I guess this is the whole talk is a conversation for another time, but just briefly, you know, when we look at the sinonasal cavity, you know, those normal and anatomical structures, the septum and the turbinates, those turbinates being those conchal structures that are embryologic in origin, they have a bony core and a soft tissue outside. They hang down generally from the sides of the nose and from the skull base. They serve a normal function, humidification of the air, filtering of the air as it goes, and sensation of airflow. But especially the top parts of the middle turbinates and almost the entirety of the superior turbinate have smell fibers that live in them, part of that epithelium. And then the other portion of the nose is the olfactory cleft, in the ethmoid skull base, and the extension of that skull base down into the superior and the posterior septum, that bony septum area. That's where a lot of the olfactory fibers live. And so with that knowledge, we know to try to protect those areas of smell. So when Dr. Sivakumar and I do a joint surgery, endonasal surgery, or even when I do endoscopic sinus surgery, I know to, you know, protect that area in the superior turbinate and to protect that area in the superior septum. So what we do is we try to move those structures out of the way without physically resecting them, so that after the surgery, although they're shocked, they have a chance to recover. And that's one of the other things that I do in the postoperative period. When we know that we don't resect any of those areas, the other thing that I look out for is scarring in those areas, which can happen after surgery. So I make sure that there's no physical obstruction to airflow within those regions so that those smell fibers can continue to do their job within the sinonasal cavity.
I would say, you know, with the surgical technique, but also a lot of the other sinonasal pathology that you guys frequently deal with at the time of the approach for these endonasal pituitary tumor surgeries, a lot of patients do report actually smelling better than they did before surgery, which is, I think, a very interesting point.
Yeah, that could certainly be the case if we're improving airflow and we're decreasing the amount of inflammatory disease, especially for those patients that I do surgery on for sinonasal inflammatory disease. Yeah. Their smell can improve.
One of the attendees asked, would you do a management of taste and smell impairment for our next lecture? That sounds wonderful. I think you're getting roped in again.
Yeah, we could go more deep into that. This was a little bit of a big test of physiology and diagnosis and stuff, but yeah.
You know, you alluded to the neurodegenerative disease work, and I know you didn't have time to touch upon that, but from a neurosurgical space, that represents a potentially very interesting future pathway. A lot of Parkinson's disease patients present with smell loss, and
yes.
There's quite a bit of data showing an improvement in tangible and objective olfaction following deep brain stimulation for some of the structures that are related to olfaction from the cortical standpoint, the subthalamic nucleus, among others, that you showed on one of those slides. So I am curious to see how that sort of plays itself out.
I will say that, you know, one is I personally think that olfactory training would be really helpful for those patients as well, because I think that there is an interplay between input and output as well. Mm-hmm. It's that if you can stimulate and provide more of olfactory input into those regions, it may have a beneficial effect on not just smell, but also those things that are related to smell, memory, cognition, emotion, those types of things. And then I will also say that my previous mentor at Stanford, Zara Patel, who's very much into smell loss, has been working on certain things to investigate the smell loss link to things like Parkinson's disease and our ability to screen for or diagnose neurodegenerative diseases sooner by using the olfactory pathway as a screening route.
Which is noted as one of the early, you know, predictors of a lot of these neurodegenerative diseases. With that, let me run through this list here very quickly.
Oh, sorry. Let me in the chat just put down my contact info.
Yes.
If anyone needs.
If nobody has, Dr. Yong is putting in his phone number, which we appreciate there. If nobody has any additional questions, this neurodegenerative discussion leads to a good segue for next month, where Dr. Natalie Diaz will be presenting on Parkinson's disease. So we'll readdress that point at that time. Thank you, Dr. Yong. That was a phenomenal talk and led to a flurry of great questions and discussion points that are going to be a good discussion or a good backdrop for future talks to come. So we do hope you'll come back. We're going to make you come back, as you know.
Yeah, of course. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you, everybody, for attending. Please have a happy and healthy start to the new year. And we'll see you in February with Dr. Natalie Diaz. Take care, everyone.
Okay, take care, guys. Thank you.